Just as-salamu alaykum. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, ten. What did he say? Ten. And another man entered, he said, as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 20. So a third man entered and he said, as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 30. And then he explained, the first one get how many rewards? 10. The one that said as-salamu alaykum. The one that said as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, he gets how many rewards? 20. And the one that said as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, how many rewards he get? 30 rewards. Did he have to go work so hard the whole day to get 10 or 20 or 30? Maybe easy, right? So don't be greedy with the salam. When a person is not giving salam, he's a greedy. You know what the greedy person is? Doesn't give, right? So give the salam. So when we say salam, this is one thing. But if someone says salam to you, then you have to reply with, if I say assalamu alaikum to you, what's the minimum requirement that is an obligation of you to say? If I say assalamu alaikum, what's the minimum? What should you say? Wa alaikum assalam, right? Can you say wa alaikum? Listen, you have to say at least wa alaykum as-salam. If I say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, what's the minimum that you have to say? Say everybody. If I say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah, that's the minimum, this is the obligation. If you say wa barakatuh, this is better, right? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that in the Quran, لَبْيُّدُ بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّ بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْضُ. If someone greeted you with a greeting, reply with a better one. Or at least reply the same way. But what if I say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh? Can you say wa alaikum assalam? Can you say wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah? No. You have to say one. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That means you have to be paying attention when someone is giving you the salam. It's not high. Assalamu alaikum is not high, right? It's something that has meaning to it. So you have to be paying attention. Whenever a Muslim is giving salam to you, this is some work to be done. You have to listen carefully. Is he saying assalamu alaikum only? Or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah? Or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh? Because now it becomes religion. When you becomes the right of that Muslim, you have to reply at least the same way he said, the salam, or it's better for you to add more to it. So to be on the same side, always add. Someone says assalamu alaikum only, then you say wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Right? So get used to this and always respond to the salam when you're awake, right? When you're alert, you know what you're doing, you know what you're saying, because this is a dua. We're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that Muslim to be safe from all harm, and for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be on him, and for the blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our religion is a beautiful thing, that from the very first moment that we meet, right, we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for each other, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from harm, that Allah have mercy on us, that Allah blesses us. So see, when a person then meets another, he says, how you doing, or hi, there's nothing of this. No blessings like you would get if you say assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and so on. Okay, so when someone says assalamu alaikum, or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, make sure that you respond inshaAllah ta'ala and guys. We'll talk about that later inshaAllah. So this is just a quick reminder. Let's start first with the Quran. Yesterday we recited Surah Al-Fatiha, and we all, alhamdulillah, have Surah Al-Fatiha memorized. And we talked about how many times we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, at least, how many times a day? 70, which is the number of raka'at of the Fardhu Salah. Right? This is the Fardhu Salah. And Surah Al-Fatiha is the best surah in the Qur'an. The best surah in the Qur'an. And that's by the mercy of Allah that we have to recite it many times every day. Therefore, we have to understand what it means. Right? The first part of the surah praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second part of the surah, you're asking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. And in the middle, you're making a covenant. You know what a covenant means? Like a contract. You're making a treaty, you're making an agreement. A heavy one. A heavy covenant between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. You all know إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. What's إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ means? No one knows? Nobody knows what إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ means? نَعْبُدُ. What's عِبَادَ means? عِبَادَ. Worship. So إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ means? You are the one that we worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that we worship. We say that in Surah Al-Fajr. Wa Allah, you are the only one that I worship. Wa iyyaka nasta'in, you are the only one that I seek help. Right? I seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pay attention to me. So, nasta'in means seeking help. Right? We all need help, right? Anybody doesn't need help with anything? But we all need help. Right? We need help to learn. We need help to even live our life. Right. Who's the one that we seek help from? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not just in words, this is belief in words, and we have to do that, we have to practice this. Right? We have to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many people they find it sometimes difficult to wake up for Fajr Salah and pray? What time Fajr starts? Anybody knows? 5 o'clock, mashallah. Fajr starts at 5 o'clock. So, Salat al-Fajr after 5, and on a Saturday maybe we pray 5:30, right? So it's early. Most people are asleep at this time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be awake to make our salah. So when a person is sleepy and he wants to wake up for Salat al-Fajr, right? He needs to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah make your salah perfectly in specified time. Like, because alone, on our own self, we're weak, we're lazy. So we need the help from Allah. The strongest person is the one that seeks help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And try that. Always ask help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you strength, will make you stronger. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous, he's the most merciful. So let's recite Surah Al-Fatiha again today only, and then inshallah tomorrow we'll start with the Surah of the week. So, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين.
الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم.
speak, we have to have an intention. Nobody actually on the face of the earth do anything without intentions. People have intentions. They do things with a certain specific intention. So the niyyah or the intention, without it, the deeds are not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where is the place of the niyyah, the intention? It's in your heart. And the hadith, the very famous hadith that we should all memorize, we'll take the first sentence of it, or the first two sentences of the hadith, which says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Say it again. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Let's keep it for me for this sentence. إِنَّمَا إِنَّمَا Look at me. إِنَّمَا إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ
إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ
بِالنِّيَّةِ. How many words? Three. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. You know what إِنَّمَا means? Nama means indeed, verily, for sure, no doubt, right? Because what comes after this is something that is for sure, something for, you know, for real. Innama al-a'malu, al-a'mal means deeds. Amal is one deed. What is it called? Amal. Say amal. If it's one, if it's more than one, if it's three or more, you say a'mal. Say what? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ Say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ
إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ
Deeds, definitely, for sure, deeds are by their intentions. بِالنِّيَّةِ Say, بِالنِّيَّةِ By the intentions. And نِيَّةِ is the plural of نِيَّةِ. نِيَّةِ is intention. نِيَّةِ means intentions. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying, that the deeds are according to their intentions, right? I can do all kinds of good things. If I have $1 million, I give it all in charity. Isn't that a good deed? Is that a good deed or a bad deed? Good deed, you all agree? It's a good deed, right? Helping the poor people, so I give them $1 million, right? They all get it. But what I get the reward for it, if I do this, yeah, right? Just because I gave the money, or there's something that has to be in my heart first. My intentions. See how dangerous and important that is? If a person gives $1 billion in charity, right? How much rewards there is? If a person recites the whole entire Quran, how many surahs in the Quran? 114 surahs, right? How many words in the Quran? 600 only? 6,000 something? How many letters in the Quran? Okay, this is for you to find out. How many letters in the Quran? How much a reward for one letter? 10 hasanat. Right? So when you say alif lam mim, how many? Three letters? Times what? Times 10 is 30. If you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, so much reward. Right? So if a person recites the whole entire Quran, millions and millions of rewards, right? Good deeds. But does that person get the reward automatically like this once he recites? He gets the reward? Or he has to have his intentions. What does his intentions have to be? That person that gave the $1 billion in charity, was he doing that to show off? Or to help the poor? Helping the poor, people would do this. But it's not sufficient, it's not enough for your intentions to help the poor. Do you have to help the poor for the sake of Allah? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you seeking rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? See the importance of intentions? So your deed is not a good deed unless you have with it the good intentions. You understand? So when someone tells us to do good deeds, actually, we should change that a little bit. We should say we should have good intentions. We should have what? Are you guys listening? So what you need to do, and as I told you, the deen is something that we have to practice. I'm not teaching you something that you only have in your mind And in the time of the day of the exam, you write it down and that's it. So the dean, if you want to get an A plus in your dean, that means you have to practice it. So our hearts have to work. So if one thing that I will tell you, always have good intentions. Always have what? Good intentions. If you have good intentions, right, then you need to know, you need to have the knowledge of what is good and what is bad, then you will be the best person ever. So when you make your salah, what's your intention in your heart? Why are you making salah? Because the principal called you for the masjid to make salah? So why you make salah? Because who ordered us to make salah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you're making salah seeking rewards from whom? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What if someone, wal'ayadhu billah, will tell you, no salah dhuhr for you today, because you were misbehaving, so you're not going to make salah to dhuhr today. What should you do? Someone tell you, no salah to dhuhr for you today because you were not acting properly. You should be ashamed of yourself first that you did not act properly, right? Because you should always act good because you are good, mashallah. And you should repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on and so forth. But should you listen to that person? No, because who's the one that ordered you to make salah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nobody is to tell us not to make salah. So we have to make salah. So this is the intention. You're making your salah only for the sake of Allah. When you stand up and you make turaqah or furaq, say furaq, right? You say Allahu Akbar. Are you praying dhuhr or asr or isha? Or which prayer are you praying? Right? Do you say, I am about to pray salatul dhuhr? And then you say Allahu Akbar. Do you do it like this? So if you say Allahu Akbar only, do I know that you're praying dhuhr or asr or isha? Can you pray at the time of dhuhr, salatul isha? So you're praying dhuhr, right? So what makes it salatul dhuhr? What in your heart, your intentions, that you're praying salatul dhuhr? You understand? We don't say anything. We don't say nawaitu. We don't say I have the intention to pray salatul dhuhr. We don't stop and focus on things like this. But we know in our hearts that we're praying salatul dhuhr. Understand? Otherwise the salah is not valid. If a person, he saw people praying, so he started praying with them. Then after he finished, oh, I prayed 4 o'clock. What time is it? It's 1 o'clock. Oh, let me make it salatul dhuhr. Does that count? It doesn't count. Why? Because you have to have the intentions when you're praying, that you're praying this specific salah. You understand? And it's all in your heart. You don't say anything when you're about to make your salah. So see the importance of the intention. If a person intended to do something evil and he was not able to do it, he got the punishment of doing something evil. He took all the means and then he was not able to do it. That's the importance of intention. The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the authentic hadith, يَغْزُ جَيْشٌ الْكَعْبَةِ. An army would go invade the Kaaba. What's the Kaaba? The house of Allah. The first house built. Who built the Kaaba? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Right? And what do we do when we go to the Kaaba? Where's the Kaaba? What city? In Mecca. What's the best city on earth? Mecca. Right? When we go to the Kaaba, we go to Mecca. Right? We go to do what? Make Hajj and make Umrah. Like, what is the ibadah that we do in the Kaaba? The only place on earth that you do what? Tawaf. What's tawaf? To go around the Kaaba 7 times. The only place on earth that you can do this and act of worship. So anyway, so this is the holiest place, the best place on earth, right? That we all face, your eyes are facing the Kaaba now, facing the Qibla, right? Every Muslim when he makes salah, faces Mecca, he faces the Kaaba. So this is the most important place for us as Muslims. So the Prophet ﷺ is saying an army would go invade the Kaaba to try to destroy the Kaaba. This is something that will happen in the future. Then he said, when this army is going and they become in an open place in the desert going to the Kaaba, so this army is going there and once they are in some place open, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy the beginning and the end of this army. They will be all destroyed at once. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy them all. You understand? Because they're going to invade the Kaaba. So then the Prophet was Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Prophet, O Prophet of Allah, there might be people among them that are not with them. There are just people happen to be there, you know, within this army. They're, you know, being present there, they're being dragged with them. They have no will to be there. And everybody will be destroyed. So would they also be with them? The Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? He said, yes, they all will be destroyed, but then, ثُمَّ يُبْعَثُونَ عَلَمْ يَتِينَ. Then they will be resurrected according to their intentions. You understand? So the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down on all of this army and also the people that are happen to be there. They're not going to invade the Kaaba, but they happen to be there, they all will die. But then in the Day of Judgment, when they're resurrected, they will be resurrected according to their intentions. So those who intended to go to invade the Kaaba, they will be in hellfire, right? And those who were not, they will not be with them. They won't be in hellfire. So what separated both? You look from a distance, if you're looking above, they're all the same, right? But what made one saved and one is not saved? The intentions, right? And on the other hand, the Prophet ﷺ, when he one time he was going in one of the expeditions with the Sahaba or the companions radiallahu anhu, and he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that we left people in Al-Madina, they did not come with us. He said, مَسِرْتُ الْمَسِيرُ. He did not walk any place. He did not go to any valley, not do anything unless they are with you in the ajr, in the reward. حَبَسَهُ الْعُضْرُ. They had an excuse, they were not able to make it with us. Right? So the people in Medina, they did not go out to the Prophet ﷺ. They had an excuse, a valid excuse. They get the full reward even though they stayed home. What made them reach this level? Their intentions. Their what? Their intentions. And when the intentions are sincere, the person gets great rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like we can go on and on with great evidences of how the importance of the intentions is. It's the best tijara, the best trade with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you always have good intentions. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah used to teach his son like this. He would say to him one thing, always have good intentions. Always have what? Inwi khayran. Always intend to do good. Shaitan will come and whisper to you to do something bad. Always intend to do good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you to do good, and that's what is left is to have the knowledge. The way of the Prophet, the Sunnah of the Prophet, when you put both together, these are the conditions for the deed to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.